Hi, everyone. Welcome. So I'm just going to preface this talk by saying that there will be moments where I would just like to stop and ask you all to sort of enter into the discourse, right? Because I think we are living in strange and dangerous, or maybe strangerous times, right? That have always sort of been strange and dangerous. Right? I think so far as humanity has been around, times have not been so safe for at least one body on the planet. So tonight's talk is really about how are we going to unpack sort of the current climate that we live in and the atmosphere as it is now, the way that we all sort of experience it, which is not the same, okay? And that's sort of the idea that I want to push the most, is that we are a very diverse group just in this room, and thinking about how our daily, minutely lived experiences are not the same from one person to the next, right? And that's based on a whole bunch of different intersecting parts of what makes us individuals, okay? So I'm going to start this talk with a personal anecdote, because I want to speak to this idea of what does it mean to be an American or an immigrant? And the mental health issues that are part and parcel with migration, okay? And we'll frame it around this idea of grief. specifically migrant grief, but we'll get to that in a second. So this class came about for me about 2 years ago, and thinking about a conversation I had with my mom, who came to the country after my dad around 36 years ago. They were in the south side of Chicago. And she and I were having a conversation on Lakeshore Drive one day while just sort of going to the grocery store, something pretty banal. And I had put on Korean pop music. And she told me to turn it off immediately. And I asked her, sort of taken aback, why do you need me to turn it off? She said, I just don't like that music. And I pushed her, well, why not? Why don't you like that music? And she's like, it's Korean, and I don't like it. And I thought, okay, well, let me just get this straight here, right? Your last name is Kim. That's like the Smith for Koreans, okay? And you don't like being Korean. She said, no, I don't. And she stopped there for a long time, and I asked her, well, why do you feel like that? And she said, she's been too far gone from there to feel like she belongs there. And I asked her, well, then obviously you must feel American. And she said, no, I don't. She came to America at the age of 25, and she is now in her 60s. And so thinking about what that means, she doesn't feel Korean, and she doesn't feel American. So we'll start there. This is a photo on the left of my grandparents. So this is 1954. They are getting married after my grandfather and his two brothers escaped from North Korea during the Japanese occupation. What's powerful about that photo is that my great-grandfather, his father, never had a photograph taken. He didn't because he was in the resistance movement against the Japanese occupation. And so as things are sort of getting hotter up north, my grandfather comes with his brothers and leaves both parents and two sisters behind. Now that he's married, there is no more contact with the rest of his family. And the way that the North Korean government sort of worked was that, well, if you left, that's it for you. You lose your family, along with everything that you've left behind, right, materially. So how does this play out for an individual who, we now are talking about this idea of grief? when grief is ambiguous. Right, when we think about grief, we think about losing a loved one. When you lose a loved one, ritually in America, what sort of happens?
There's a funeral.
Why do we have a funeral?
To say goodbye.
To say goodbye. Mm-hmm. Why do we need to say goodbye?
To be closure.
Closure. Amen. Right. Absolutely. But when it's ambiguous, say, you know, somebody in your neighborhood had a dog, right? That dog disappeared one day. Where is the closure of that? The fact that you have no idea what happened to this dog, if the dog was run over by a car, or ideally might have been taken by somebody who thought it was so cute, let me give you a better life, and it's now happily somewhere, right? But the imagination takes you a whole bunch of different places on that spectrum and everywhere in between. So for their marriage, my grandmother, who's from the South, her parents said no to him because my grandfather came with nothing. And so this idea of being a migrant, forced out of your home to go to a different place, was happening within the same ethnic group, right, in the same country. So they have 6 children, and my grandfather, according to my grandmother, drinks often. And she just can't sort of figure out why he does it. She just thinks it's a man thing to do. He does it. However, each time he drinks, the paranoia from the trauma that he experienced leaving his home and his family exhibits itself. So in these moments where my grandmother is going out to maybe get toys or groceries to take care of the family, my grandfather will, or he did, ask her very aggressively, where have you been? Right. Why do you need to leave? Why did you leave without me? So when we think about what we see in a picture, what we see in an image, is oftentimes the way that we are able to see each other, right? I'm pretty sure there's a lot of backgrounds in this room, people of all ages coming from all over the place. But the amount of time it takes to get to know who that person is, right, as an individual, and the makeup of your individuality, is a lot more time than we have on the planet to exist. Right? And that is just a truth. And for immigrants, like my grandparents and later on my parents, they are existing in a life that many of us cannot actually imagine. Right? And that's a type of privilege that we need to acknowledge. So, 30 years later, here are my lovely parents and myself. And we're sat in a field somewhere. I have no idea where that is, but I am too. Okay. And my mom looks super happy. I look pretty happy. And my dad looks very stoic and serious. Okay. Why does he look so stoic and serious? Well, when we moved to Chicago, when they moved to Chicago, they brought us up in an area very close to Midway Airport. Okay. And that is technically the south side of Chicago. What is happening here that's highlighted, thank you Google Maps, is approximately what used to be 40 acres of public housing called the LeClaire Courts. So they were low row house projects. And where our house was if you look at that yellow strip that's going vertically on one end, 48th Street, between 48th and 49th is where our house was. And on 48th Street, is where my father had a hardware store. And so as a child, going to school nearby, after school, I would stay with my dad and we would work at the hardware store together. So if you need like help with plumbing or like, you know, stuff putting up drywall, I can actually do that, right? So is my dad. And I remember being maybe 5, 6, I mean, very young, witnessing my father getting robbed by a black male. And in that moment, I remember staring out the window as the man is running outside to a car that's waiting, right, to drive the the individual away, and my dad, who is like a third degree black belt in Taekwondo, or Taekwondo, as Korean people would pronounce it, throws his fist through the glass, right, grabs the guy from the passenger seat, and pulls him half out of the car. This is an image that's emblazoned in my mind, right, watching my father in this sort of moment of violence. And other ways in which the violence near where we were living was playing out, right? But when we think about immigrants, and you think about the American dream, immigrants who come here are experiencing the loss of their home, coming to create a new place to live, a home for themselves, and it's not necessarily going to be an idyllic place. So having already experienced trauma, going to a new land where you had a certain level of expectation, right? And it's the reality that doesn't meet that. What then happens to you in your mind, right? Especially when you are a male in your 30s, supporting a family, and thinking about how you will keep them safe. So, taking a second just to talk about grief. How would you define grief? And it's like such a happy thing to talk about. If you have ever experienced grief in your life, what does that look like?
Grief of loss.
Loss, yeah.
The numbness.
It's generally very overwhelming.
It's overwhelming. Okay, we have a lot of words, but draw me a picture here. What does loss look like, right? What does overwhelmed look like?
I think it's kind of like a long, since kind of a long kind of sadness. It's like sadness, but kind of drives, you know, and stays with you throughout the day, you know, what you think about what you lost, or what would you like to have like back, you know, kind of like you're grieving for like a lost loved one.
Okay.
And then you kind of think, you know, this person's gone, you know, what's real, what's what going to be like now without them.
Okay. Absolutely. Are we skipping down the street? No.
It's inescapable.
It is inescapable. But how could you tell somebody is experiencing grief? Paint us a picture.
They're not taking care of themselves.
They're not taking care of themselves.
They're tired and sad. They're not laughing.
Okay. Could you still be grieving and laughing with someone?
Yes.
Why would you do that?
To try and get over the gap that grief creates.
Yeah. So there is a kind of grief that clinically is called disenfranchised grief. I mean, that's, yeah. Okay. So, what disenfranchised grief, according to clinicians, is this idea that, you know, it's acceptable to cry. It's acceptable to not feel like getting out of bed. But when you're in certain contexts, it becomes unacceptable. And what do I mean by that? Well, if you are a male, what does it look like to others when you cry? Stereotypically.
Weak.
Mm-hmm. You seem weak. Other words for that?
Effeminate?
Soft.
Effeminate, soft, vulnerable. Right. You look human. So the problem with disenfranchised grief is that you are asking a human being not to be human. And for someone who is unable to process grief, right, this turns into a whole host of other consequences and issues where to other people it looks like, oh my God, get yourself together. Right? Why can't you just do this? If you think about it hard enough, you can just get over it. chances are it may be that that person might not have experienced grief. Right? Might be thinking about it in such an abstract sense that they are further away from the emotional baggage, right, that grief is weighing down on human souls. So, as we continue, what are we dealing with? By we, I mean me. Right? I also have a brother, and the other members of my family. So I have up here photos of two very famous Korean actors. They have recently appeared in dramas, and they're on all sorts of TV commercials and advertisements in South Korea. Okay. The pictures on the left versus the pictures on the right. What looks so different? Do they look different?
Much more Western.
Much more Western? What do you mean by that?
Whiter.
Whiter.
Mm-hmm. Photoshopped.
More Photoshopped, yeah. That's real. Mm-hmm. So if you notice very specific physiological changes, right, at the jawline. So you have a more masculine square jaw on the left. And on the right, it's become more feminine, V-shaped. For this young lady in her, I think this is her junior high, early high school photo, there's a huge difference between the way that her eyes look and the way that the rest of her face has been slimmed down in the same way. So, all of my aunts, it turned out, had blepharoplasty. Anybody cosmetic surgeons, right, or inclined to be one, I have no idea, or know what blepharoplasty is?
The
eyelid surgery. Excellent. After the Korean War, cosmetic surgery really comes to fruition in World War I, right, where we are seeing the most insane kinds of technology come forth to destroy human beings, right? And what one particular form of it is mustard gas that literally melts your face off. People who had been mortared, and shells that have just caved in the face. So doctors came and thought, well, we're going to rebuild your face. Similarly, doctors came into Korea and thought that they were doing people a favor. Absolutely they were going to rebuild your face. But they decided, well, through our lens, your eyes are kind of small. And there's a very famous doctor by the last name Millard, who's been written about, I think, very recently in The New Yorker, maybe a year ago, The Atlantic, where he was talking about how inexpressive the Asian eye is. And so that he would help to make them more expressive. This is from a Western eye. You said the video will play if I press?
One of the sisters is obviously black, the other is white.
The Alma twins come from a mixed race family in the UK. Maria has taken after her half Jamaican mum with dark skin and brown eyes and curly dark hair. But Lucy got her dad's fair skin, good on her, along with straight red.
Wow.
Okay. So how many of you have seen this before? Yeah.
Wow.
Okay. So if we think about biology, fraternal twins means what? Separate eggs in the same uterus, right? In a biracial family, that means that those two eggs will be fertilized by the same sperm, two different sperm.
Different sperm.
Exactly. So about one out of 500 fraternal twins born to biracial couples do not come out with the same skin color. So in this case, on this Australian morning show, they were interviewing a pair of British twins. And the lovely woman on the left, what do we feel about that comment? What do we think about that? Are we shocked? Some of you say no. Why are you not shocked?
She's Australian.
She's Australian. Well, yeah, she sure is. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by that?
I'm just thinking of the sort of incipient racism in Australian culture and how they treat people of color.
Okay, yeah.
How do you get away with that comment still?
Okay. Other thoughts? Why is it not shocking?
Because Americans do it too.
Americans do it too?
Because she's nonchalant.
Because she's
nonchalant, just in passing.
Just in passing. Do you think she thought about it before she said that?
No.
Mm-hmm. So, thinking about immigrants and where they come from and coming to a world where that might be the predominant thought, right? That what you should look like is like her. That in order to be American, in order to be accepted and feel safe where you are, that you should look more like her. So this phenomenon is connected to the historical event that is the Great Migration. Are we familiar with this? That happens in the early 20th century? Okay, so what is the Great Migration?
The move of African Americans northward.
The
move
removal?
Northward. Move.
Right, the move from the south
to the north.
To the north. Mm-hmm. And so one of the amazing aspects of the Great Migration is that African Americans who were living in the south, primarily in states like Louisiana, where there was a larger European context, that intermarriage was more prominent than it was in the north. So we find individuals that moved up north with lighter skin. Skin light enough that they could pass for being white. Why might this be problematic? Thoughts?
Why is passing? Why would that be problematic?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, because they're living a lie and they have to conceal their family who may not be able to pass.
Mm-hmm.
Psychologically, that would weigh on them.
Absolutely. And why would somebody go through that kind of psychological trauma?
Because they believe they're going to have a better life.
A better life. Absolutely. And so, for me, I think Nella Larsen's passing is one of the books that absolutely opens my eyes to what it is like not to look like everybody else around me. To have to pretend to be somebody else to the extent where there are times where I feel like I forget what I look like. And it's come to a point where I have to sort of check myself. What does it mean for me that now I walk around and I don't really realize my own countenance, and that it's come to bear for me that other people do. So, we're just gonna sort of like dive in. How many of you are familiar with Larsen's passing? I've heard it before? Okay. I don't have handouts, but we do have specific excerpts that I wanna look at and sort of talk about. The book is divided into several parts, and the first part is aptly titled Encounter. So, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, the word encounter means to come up against an adversary. So when we talk about encountering somebody in the street, what you're really saying is you've met your enemy, somebody that you are going to duel. Which is not the common usage today. But for Larsen, it's a very, very specific definition. And she is pitting one woman who passes in her life but is married to a black man with another character who passes and is married to a white man who has no idea that she is black. She opens with an epigram, which is an excerpt out of County Cullen's poem, Heritage. Is anyone familiar with this poem specifically? County Cullen? Yeah? Okay. You're just like so shy. It's okay. Be proud. County Cullen is extraordinary. He is a talent that should be rung out on high in every humanities department on the planet. Right? Why do I say this? How many of you know that he is the first African American to translate a classical Greek play? Idea? He specifically chooses Medea. Are we familiar with the story of Medea? Yeah? Okay, so I know that you know, so now you're gonna participate, yes? I can call on you to tell us. Just give us a brief synopsis. What's Medea, though?
It's about a very jealous woman who winds up killing her children to mm-hmm. get back at her husband who's cheating on her.
Okay. Yeah? That's like the climax and the denouement, all of that. Okay, so when I teach it in class, I bring in the copy of the book, which cost me almost $150 to obtain. Okay, this book has been out of print since 1940, since the 1940s, about there. And it was astonishing to me. Why is it out of print? When the book came out in the 1930s, there was a Kirkus review. And today, Kirkus Review is sort of this big name in publishing, right? When books come out, Kirkus reviews it, and it sells more. Or it's one of the entities that helps you do that, okay? The review was maybe three sentences, and I print it out and show it to my students. And the review speaks to the fact that, yes, he has translated this great Greek work of tragedy, however, it then goes on to be dismissive. That the prose is okay, and it probably won't sell him more books. And it ends there. And I found it fascinating that there was no discussion in terms of why Cullen chose Medea, why this of any Greek play. And it turns out, right, that Medea in traditional mythology is portrayed as a woman who has dark, wiry hair. Darker skin. She comes from a land called Colchis that is known for a more savage people. And it is to this land that Jason, a Western Greek hero, comes to claim the Golden Fleece to get back his throne. The idea of the story is really one of slavery. Why? Because Jason comes in and takes Medea, exploits her abilities so that he can get what he wants. And when he takes her back to Greece, he leaves her to consolidate power with a white princess. So the story continues, and you are right. She kills her two sons because she is enraged. Well, let me ask you. If your partner had you do some pretty despicable things, right, to help him or her or them out, and then just said, you know what, I'm just gonna go over there now and we'll take care of you. This is in your best interest. Leaves you for another person. I'm pretty sure I'd do that too. Right? But there's that added violence. Medea kills her two children, her own children. Any thoughts as to why she would do that, besides just being abject, attributing it to abject evil? If it's not evil, what else could it be?
Fear that her children would be enslaved like she would.
That they might
be enslaved
like her, yeah.
Mental illness.
Other thoughts? If Jason leaves her for another woman, chances are, what might happen between the two of them? They'll have children of their own. And if we know anything about history, man, especially with power, if you got kids with another person, somebody's got to go. So looking at it as a tale really of a mother's mercy, would I want to see my own children presumably tortured, right, killed at the hands of people who would be butchers versus doing it myself? So this for me is an important place to start, because when we look at the first chapter, we're looking at the character Claire Kendry. So Claire is passing and married to a white man who doesn't know that she's black. And what I wanted to look at is the sort of image that's painted for us by Larsen. And I'll just read it out loud. And for a swift moment, Irene Redfield seemed to see a pale, small girl sitting on a ragged blue sofa, sewing pieces of bright red cloth together while her drunken father, a tall, powerfully built man, raged threateningly up and down the shabby room, bellowing curses and making spasmodic lunges at her, which were not the less frightening because they were, for the most part, ineffectual. Sometimes he did manage to reach her, but only the fact that the child had edged herself and her poor sewing over to the farthermost corner of the sofa suggested that she was in any way perturbed by this menace to herself and her work. So, we look back at Cullen, the fact that he translates Medea, right? He's thinking about his relationship to where his ancestors come from. So in the epigram, we have 1-3 centuries removed from the scenes his father loved. What is Africa to me? 300 years later, what does that place called home actually mean? Right? It's a powerful thing to think about because the colors that are depicted in this opening for the book, a pale, small girl. Pale may equate to what color for us? White. Mm-hmm. Sitting on a blue sofa, sewing together red cloth. So if we just sort of like reorder those colors, what do we get? Red, white, and blue. And what's red, white, and blue, American? And non-American?
American.
We won't call you out, you know, because Trump might be somewhere. Red, white, blue. It's powerful because those are not just the colors that are there, but the cloth that's red is being sewn together poorly by this child. And so when we think about what that symbolism means, right, for people who are coming from a place where they don't feel like they belong, you are literally sewing together a life. Right? You are picking up pieces to put together something that you hope is going to come out good at the end, maybe look like a blanket, maybe look like a shirt that you can put on. But it is absolutely homemade. So the idea of the story is really couched in what is happening here in America, right, what Larsen is speaking to. And as we fast forward, Claire has escaped, been married, runs into Irene, who is sort of recalling these memories of Claire, and we hit Utopos versus Utopos. This is where Thomas More's Utopia comes in. So if you look here, and I won't read this, but Claire is speaking to the fact that she feels so lonely. She has sacrificed her home life for survival, for luxury. And she's doing it living a lie, right? Which I think was brought up in the back there. She thought that that would be her utopia, similarly to the way that immigrants believe in this American dream, right? I think there was a conversation that I had earlier where people come to America thinking one thing. They have a very specific expectation, and then suddenly the reality is something very different. And within those two poles lies the tension in which mental health begins to really be something of concern, right? We'll get to that more specifically. So utopos and utopos. For Thomas More, he's writing utopia because he's living in a politically rife climate. Do we know what king he's writing under? Yeah, yeah. Father of Elizabeth?
Henry VIII,
yeah. So, we're talking about a time where religious turmoil, political turmoil, you name it. I mean, people aren't bathing regularly, food's not so good. A lot of very basic things that aren't working as well as they should. So, for Moore, when he writes it, he's using utopia in a very specific sense because it has two meanings. Anyone familiar with this, the Greek words? Yeah? Yeah?
Only for Mad Men season one.
You know, I haven't gotten into Mad Men, but I will binge it. Thank
there's,
you.
There's a line, it's like, one means like the good place and one means the place that cannot be here.
Yes! Thank you, Mad Men! What?
It's good television.
You know, the clothes are great. I mean, that's, you know. You're absolutely right. The utopos means the good place. Utopos means no place. So this utopia that Thomas More paints, if you haven't read it before, is fantastic. I'm just gonna put it out there. There's no oppression. Everybody's got their own space. Everything is great. More is writing in a period where the enclosure acts have now come along. Are we familiar with those? So way back when, neighbors didn't have fences. That property was common. If you had seeds to plant, sheep to feed, you just kind of did it on the land that was available. But the government begins to restrict this and assign property to specific people. This becomes problematic because the people that were originally there living off that land, if you want to keep it according to the government, you needed paperwork, documentation. And if you couldn't show it, you were out. And it's a powerful thing to think about because documentation for us in our society is everything. You don't have the papers, you can't. Full stop. So, for Moore, in Utopia, he's speaking of this idea that everybody is equal. Because everybody's equal, nobody wants any more than anyone else. I think there's a where he goes on to say that it is the idea that seems the most different that takes the longest for people to come around to, right? And when we think about immigrants, when we think about the people who are living in the land that immigrants are coming to, bridging the gulf between cultures, bridging the gulf between the different philosophies and ideologies that exist, the difficult task, right? And oftentimes a dominant culture, a dominant population, makes it much harder for people to know their own individuality, right? Who they are in that context. So there's a term, allostatic load, that is used in clinical therapy. We'll get to that in a second. So I want to just look at a few sentences here. We meet Claire's husband, and he is a very wealthy white man. They live in Chicago, and Irene has come finally at Claire's behest, multiple behests, to visit her old friend. Claire's husband has no idea that her friends are also passing. So, I would like to look at the first paragraph. And the man is John or Jack Ballou, Claire's husband. The man chuckled, crinkling up his eyes, not Irene was compelled to acknowledge unpleasantly. He explained, well, you see, it's like this. When we were first married, she was white as a lily. But I declare she's getting darker and darker. I tell her if she don't look out, she'll wake up one of these days and find she's turned into a nigger. Right? This is the man that Claire is married to. Meaning every day she lives with this man. We move further down to the third paragraph. Claire handed her husband his tea and laid her hand on his arm with an affectionate little gesture, speaking with confidence as well as with amusement. She said, my goodness, Jack, what difference would it make if after all these years you were to find out that I was 1 or 2% colored? Put out his hand in a repudiating fling, definite and final, oh no, Nick, which is the nickname that he's given her, that he's called her throughout their relationship. He declared, nothing like that with me. I know you're no nigger, so it's all right. You can get as black as you please, as far as I'm concerned, since I know. I draw the line at that. No niggers in my family, never have been, and never will be. John Ballou gave a short, denying laugh. You got me wrong there, Mrs. Redfield. He's responding to something that Irene has said. Nothing like that at all. I don't dislike them, I hate them. And so does Nig for all she's trying to turn into one. She wouldn't have a nigger maid around her for love nor money. Not that I'd want her to. They give me the creeps, the black scribey devils. If we skip down, Ballou answered, thank the Lord, no, and never expect to. But I know people who've known them better than they know their black selves. And I read in the papers about them, always robbing and killing people. And he added darkly, worse. So it is in this climate that Claire lives. And she's living it because she believes that that is where she can live her best. Right? And the tension that she feels when she sees her past in the form of Irene catch up with her is, it ends up too much to bear. I don't want to ruin the end. You should all read the book. It's phenomenal. Okay. But this is what allostatic load alludes to. Is anyone familiar with the term allostatic load? Yeah. Allostatic load means you are taking on all of the consequences of chronic stress. Chronic, daily, regular stress. And that this manifests itself in ways that are negative to mental health, that are negative to your physical health. So there are many statistics that talk about the fact that immigrants, individuals of color, they are susceptible to a higher degree than white individuals to sickness and to genetic issues and to other physical issues that cause shorter life expectancies because that mental stress is absolutely affecting physical stress. So, who are we? I just want to take a moment to get to know you, right? You who have come here. So, we in this room, who are we? I'll start, right? Because I don't think that like, sort of happened necessarily. So, I'm currently in my last semester. Thank you to whomever, whatever, in a social work program at Columbia. And I'm doing this on a clinical track because I've spent a long time teaching English with a master's in fine arts to individuals that were coming from very underprivileged backgrounds. And as a teacher, there was only so much that I could do, right? And it broke my heart that the work had to stop in the classroom. There just wasn't enough in terms of my own education for me to reach to the place that would be the most helpful for my students. So, why I'm coming up with clinical language or a certain terminology is that's part of my research, is looking at what it looks like for people who are not the dominant population mentally. And then in conjunction with mental health, physically. Okay. So that's like my nutshell. Okay. So why are you all here? Besides the fact that this is like the most glorious room in all the city. Yeah?
So I'm a dual national of both England, Britain, and the US, and I'm here to coincide with the inauguration for a couple of months to travel and try and discover a little bit more about what it means to be American. So that's what I'm also a second generation immigrant into the US, so this is super
awesome. Yeah?
I work with a nonprofit that tries to bring writing and ideas about literature to people who don't have access to it.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw on our listing of events this event this morning, and I wrote my undergraduate thesis on authenticity, and I don't know what I'm doing with my life at all. And
welcome to the club. Yeah.
Yes, I'm 23 and experiencing a lot of whatever rupture. So that's why I'm here.
Excellent. And I mean that in the best possible way, not like, you know, just listen to that. Yeah?
Well, I'm here because I want to see about the office, because I'm actually like an immigrant, because I was kind of talking to you earlier.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I'm from Brazil, and so I was Chilean, so I was happy because I'm a Chilean. And I came here, since I kind of saw the mess.
Yeah.
So, like, I started high school here, and I went to college, and I'm finishing grad school now, and I have a job waiting from the University of Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to see how my experience kind of matches the discussion and presentations.
Thank you for sharing. Your thoughts, yeah?
I'm a third culture kid, you described as, and I'm just interested in, you know, my experience as an expat as opposed to an immigrant.
Mm.
My dad is in the military, so most of my childhood I lived outside of the country, and
mm-hmm.
so I'm extremely interested in immigration from a standpoint of a lot of people that live in America are more American than me, technically.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an interesting way of thinking about it.
I was born in Bulgaria and spent much of my childhood denying it, actually.
Yeah.
I grew up in the United States, but denied for a long time that I was an immigrant. And then I became fascinated with it when I was in middle school and my friends started responding positively. And then I became a Trekkie.
You became a Trekkie?
A Trekkie.
A Trekkie!
Yes. So I was very excited about the combination of immigration and Star Trek.
Yes. Oh, we're getting there.
I'm waiting for it.
Yes. Other thoughts? Yeah?
My mom is from Sierra Leone, West Africa.
Okay.
So I grew up hearing about her stories about like getting used to being living in America,
mm-hmm.
and dealing with all the differences that she had versus the differences back home.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I've also never heard of Star Trek. I've not never heard of Star Trek. I've never seen any. Sorry.
Heart attack. Yes.
Okay. And so I want to see how that comes together.
Yes. Don't you worry. Okay. That's all. Anyone else would like to share in this moment? Well, why am I asking who are we? Because the first real modern writer to ask that is, anybody know, is on that reading list if you took a look at French.
There's no eraser, so there's like the napkin. Right. It's a little bit slower.
It is Michel de Montaigne. He historically is a very interesting figure because he spent a lot of time studying to work as essentially a government official. And then around the age of 38, which back in the 16th century is kind of old, right? Not really old, but it's old enough, he gave it all up. And the sort of myth surrounding his giving that up is that he locked himself in a room with 1,000 books. So essentially, you know, if we're talking about like these, he locked himself in a room with Google, right? But Google was the printed word. And he just started asking, who am I? Reading these books and thinking about the relationship between the way that he was thinking and the way that these writers were thinking. And then about bridging the gap between the two. And he had a really interesting upbringing because he's born to a Catholic father and then a Protestant mom who is of Spanish-Jewish descent. So he's kind of in this ideological turmoil, right, with parents who don't necessarily believe the same thing, but they are trying to save face, right, and maybe be united behind one religion in particular. And at this time, we are finding Martin Luther kind of coming forth and bringing about this Protestant Reformation. I just want to give a shout out to the Erickson book, which I saw the Strand does have. It's about the young Luther. And why we talk about Luther tonight is that at the age of 18, the man is going off to study grammar and rhetoric and metaphysics because he hopes to be a lawyer. That's Martin Luther. And at 18, we know now, today, that cognitively, we don't finish developing until around the age of 25. So 23 and feeling the rupture, totally normal, okay? You are not alone. I'm like 35. And I'm still feeling the rupture. I'm the one that needs help, right? I'm just kidding. So, Martin Luther, at around 22, still very young, experiences this moment while in church. And it's some kind of episode. We're not quite sure what it is because the science at the time is not really that far ahead. But distinctly, he prays that if God can just stop whatever is happening from happening, he will devote himself to the monastic life. And sure enough, the episode ends, and he becomes a devout Catholic monk. He experiences Catholicism in a way that most people weren't at the time, which is, oh my goodness, Catholics, y'all are really corrupt, right? You're asking people to pay their way out of sin, and you're taking money from individuals like you were the government, which in fact, really they were, right? The Catholic Church is so powerful, they were more powerful than the government. How do we know this? Well, one example, back to Henry VIII, is that he wanted to divorce his first wife, Catherine of Aragon, because why?
She couldn't bear any sons.
She couldn't give him any sons. And whose fault was that, really? That's his fault, right? He's shooting, what, X chromosomes? Yeah. He had no Ys, right? And the one Y he shot was pretty weak, because that kid died very early, right? But they didn't know it then, okay? So, Martin Luther is in this place where he's just seeing all the terrible things that are happening. And Henry is like, listen, I need a divorce. Catholic Church says no. We do not give out divorces. It just doesn't happen. So what does he do? Breaks off and forms his own religion. His own beliefs, right? On essentially a whim, because he couldn't divorce his wife. Could you imagine? Thinking, I'm gonna get a divorce. Oh, the church isn't gonna let me. I'm just gonna set up this religion here in my house. Right? Just marry somebody else. But this is the King of England at the time doing this. So Luther is seeing this kind of corruption, and at the age of 32, it's extraordinary. He nails the 95 theses to the wall of the church in Forms, in Germany. He is only 32, and he takes on the largest power on the continent. And it is specifically important for us to think about, right? Because we're living in a time where, my goodness, any one of us could be that. To be the one to say no, right? To power and corruption. But we'll get to that later. I'm getting that. So Montaigne is asking, who am I? In a very particular essay entitled Of Cannibals, he is examining all of the sort of stories that are coming back from the New World, right? The ways in which Native peoples are being depicted. And in this essay in particular, he's exploring cannibalism, the act of eating another human being. And what he ends up doing is comparing it to the rather barbaric acts that Europeans themselves have been implementing, right? Because this is a period where the Spanish Inquisition is very well known, ways in which Catholics have been barbaric to their own people. And what's magic about Montaigne, which I think education today gets a little bit farther away from, I think when you're in high school and college and people are teaching you to write essays, how are you supposed to write your essay? In which person, should I ask, be more specific? Third person, absolutely. But the man who gives us the essay because the word essay comes from the French word essayé. Are we familiar with what essayé means? To try. Yeah. That's where essay comes from. His essays are written in the first person. Why are they? Because he's trying to understand. Understand what? Just understand. His philosophy is that inasmuch as he doesn't know somebody there down the street or even the person living in his house, he doesn't know himself. And it's a powerful thing to think about because even for the Greeks, right, if we just like throw this back a couple thousand years, the Oracle at Delphi, which is a very famous place that people from around the world were coming to sort of get a glimpse of what their future would be like. At the very front of the entrance was engraved the words, "Know thyself." So, why is it that when you're going to a place where possibly your future will be unraveled for you, with the first thing that you're being told as a pilgrim, know thyself? Thoughts? Any ideas? What does it mean to know yourself? And how many of you would cop to knowing yourself? Do you know yourself? You say no. Other people just don't want to answer.
You know your values. You can prioritize things and describe to someone what you value over and above what they might value.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
So values are a part of you. Yeah. Your identity, I should say. Mm-hmm. Good ideas? Do you know yourself? And in what ways do you know yourself? When you undergo crisis?
Cannibalism being an example. Would you meet the guy next to you if you had to?
And you know that, you would?
I personally do not.
You personally, thank you for qualifying that. You don't speak for everyone in the room, right? Yeah.
Well, that's certainly a good way just to extend that idea.
Yeah.
I like to think that a very good strategy before getting to know myself is to sort of expose myself to as many things as possible.
Yeah.
So, and learn about myself through the reactions that I have to those sometimes. And I'm just pleasantly surprised.
Absolutely. This idea that when you're trying to understand, that after understand is just kind of a, like, or that it's always a question and not a statement. That there might not be an answer, and we kind of have to be okay with that. For a lot of immigrants, right, you come thinking that a new place will be the answer. And when that isn't the answer, where do you turn to? Where do you go? For Montaigne, he is giving us this amazing sort of ability to think about what it's like over there, right? Away and external from us. And oftentimes, when we think about our own lives, like how many of us actually have the time to think about, say, over there? Right? If we might be under assault from the exact environment or context that we are currently in, whether that is socio-economically, racially, gendered, etc. So, now, all right. Okay, so now we're getting to the board. Right. I'm just going to preface this by saying that Star Trek, for me, has a special place in my soul because I grew up in a neighborhood where there was nobody else that looked like this. Nobody. And all the kids that I went to school with were more than excited to reinforce the idea that nobody else looked like me. And what do I mean by that? Well, it was, can I get the number 6 chop suey? Right? Can I know? Get kids, right? Doing like the slanty eye thing, okay? Or trying to speak to me in what they thought was Chinese. I'm not gonna mimic that here. That runs deep for me, right? But this was a daily sort of thing. And there was one particular kid who just, every day, all the time. And so finally, I said, listen, at least I have a mother. It was true. His mom left, I think, when he was very young. And I was just tired of it. And the first thing that ended up happening was that the teacher, who's white, brought me over and said, you can never do that. That is very hurtful. You can never say things like that. And I said, oh my goodness, I'm very sorry. But what about all of these things that he has been saying to me for like 3 months now? 4 months now. And she said, no, those are just jokes. Okay. And that's what I get in around 7 or 8. And so this idea that it's me that must be crazy. I think there's a term for that these days, gaslighting. Are we familiar with those? Okay. Where something has happened, but then it's been invalidated for you to the point where it makes you feel like, oh, it's me that's crazy. All that stuff. Don't know what you're talking about. So for Star Trek, this idea that there's a ship full of people where they're going out to meet new folks. New folks that then are brought on board and kind of become part of the crew. And it was a really beautiful idea that I wasn't experiencing in my real life because it was fairly isolating. So in particular, tonight, we're looking at the Borg, an alien species whose entire existence is based on the idea of assimilation. Right? You have to assimilate. We're going to take you, and you're just gonna become one of us. This becomes problematic later in the series because the crew ends up finding a lone adolescent Borg, adolescent and impressionable, and he begins to get a hint of what individuality is. Because the idea of the Borg is that they are a collective. They think as a hive, as one. There are no individuals. So one has been taken away, feels individuality and everything that sort of comes with the upending of what you thought your life was. So here, We are looking at the individuals that sort of assimilated individuality. And in that moment, they are vulnerable and open to presence and the sway of a demagogue. Sound familiar to anyone? Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
There you are, brother. Here's the visor. May I ask why you wanted it? Thought it might look good on me. What do you think? Maybe we should work on your sense of humor, brother. Actually, I was thinking LaForge's implants might make him an ideal test subject for my experiment. All of the Borg you have experimented on so far have suffered extensive brain damage. Using the humans to perfect the procedure will allow us to prevent any further Borg deaths. I understand. What is it? This Borg has disconnected himself from the others. He would not let me hear his thoughts. I've asked you to stay linked to Krosis at all times. You know that, don't you?
Yes.
I know this must be difficult for you. Well, uncertain you must feel. All of these sensations are new. And they can be frightening. Isn't that right?
Yes. I have doubts.
Of course you do. It's only natural. No one is going to blame you for that. But in order to lose those doubts, to keep fear and confusion away, I need you to remain linked to the others so that their strength and their confidence can help you. I need you, Govan. I need you to help me build a future for the Borg. I can't do it without you. Will you help me?
Yes, I will.
Okay. Let's talk about that scene for a second. What is happening there? What's the problem?
The two guys talking at first looked exactly like each other. So
yeah.
I wasn't sure if they were clones or.
They're brothers.
They're brothers, okay.
They're android brothers.
They are android brothers, yeah. Data and Lore. Mm-hmm.
Lore is manipulative and.
He sure is.
Controlling. But also, why did he give them all names if he's trying to have them be different? Like, that was the problem with Hugh.
Mm-hmm. So. Thank you, because you know the context of the episodes, right?
Wow.
So Hugh is the one who became individualized, right? And it turns out that Hugh, if you ever want to name your kids Hugh, okay? The name means mind, spirit, heart, the hallmarks of individuality, right? And so now that that has happened, there's a certain group of Borg that are like, mm-mm. I feel the individual bug, but I'm scared. Because now I don't feel safe because I'm not part of that collective hive. So in that moment of vulnerability, how easy is it for Lore to come and manipulate? And it turns out Lore, also if you want to name your children then, right, your child. Lore means to educate. But secondarily, it also means to destroy. And so for these Borg that are in limbo, they don't quite know where to land. And this demagogue figure in Lore comes along and manipulates them, right? Takes advantage of that fear. So I know we're running low on time, right? And I just want to get quickly to this. So what is this? I know you're shaking your head. Yes, we wish that it didn't look like that. But what is that?
Occupation.
Electro, remember you said something?
Occupation.
Occupation. Yes. It is. What I want to point out specifically, and there may be those of you here that also might have thought this,
but Chicago is there.
And much like London in Brexit, it's Chicago that carries a lot of the vote. Most of the cities that are outside of Chicago are not Democratic. And then when we look at all the states that surround Chicago, the biggest city that's really closest to them is actually Chicago. When you look at the East Coast, we have obviously New York, you also have Baltimore, Boston, DC. Look at the West Coast, you've got cities like Seattle, San Francisco, Los Angeles, big cities. But there in the middle, we have Chicago. So now here is what was so fascinating for me about Trump, right? And this idea of the board and assimilation, is after the first debate, as I was watching, I'm thinking, he's talking a lot about the violence in Chicago. And even recently, I think he threatened to send in the feds, right? Because the violence in Chicago is so great. I was looking at Facebook feeds, which, you know, sometimes I just want to jump out the window when I read the things that are posted, but it was very useful from a sociological perspective. Because Rahm Emanuel just announced, along with a handful of other mayors, that the city will stay a sanctuary city, that immigrants will be safe. And then there are all these comments where people are saying, well, listen, you should take care of the people who already live there because the violence is so crazy and people are dying and the guns and the crime. Well, it's not coming from a person who actually lives in Chicago. These are individuals who are commenting living, in Ohio, in Pennsylvania, in Iowa. They didn't live in Chicago. And so for Trump on a national stage, right, to pit people who lived around there, who knew, of course, yes, because Chicago is a huge city nearest to us, really, that this literally fanned the flames. Right, when we are talking about information these days, at the end of the day, I mean, if I came in here and I'm doing this talk and saying all these things, how do you know that I even have a degree in anything? You know? How do you know? And if I never opened my mouth and I just kind of sat here, would you assume that I spoke English based on what I look like? Or that I had an accent? What is it that we actually know, given what you know of yourself? What do you know about each other? And playing on this idea of not knowing, because you haven't experienced it. Trump and his team and all these other, you know, for lack of a better term, evil people, took advantage of individuals who, where they are living, the kind of resources that we would see in a metropolitan city don't necessarily exist. So where are their opinions and their ideas, their biases, their prejudices? What are they predicated on, really? Information that they receive from somebody who, man, is famous, looks confident. Someone like Lore. So in the same way that we all sort of experience what's happening with the way that the government is sort of now playing out, right, this panic, there are also immigrants who have been here a long time and working who aren't actually panicking. So this is a moment to sort of sit and have that discussion. Right, when we all feel like we want to do something, act, who are we acting for? Right, and based on what? Because when I talked to my parents, they saw this coming a long time ago. and it's not a surprise to them. They just find this to be an assimilation, right, of all of this rhetoric of fear boiled over in individuals that were vulnerable. Vulnerable in the way that Borg were to these outside influences. Right? So, at the end of the day, this talk has sort of like gone all over the place, and I totally get that because my mind is all over the place all the time. What I really want to emphasize is this idea that we are all individuals, but that there are still commonalities, right, where we can still come together and talk about where we come from. Because being a human being crosses an entire spectrum and then some. And I kind of think about it in this way, where in chemistry, there's a very specific type of molecular property called chirality. Are we familiar with this? Right. Anyone writes this word on the board because it's a great word?
Did somebody say they do know? It's like the right or left handedness.
Yes. Is chirality, and you're right, right or left-handedness. It's this idea that there is a mirror image, right? And though the mirror image looks the same, the images cannot be superimposed. There is a fundamental difference in the mirror image. And I think that living in this time, when we see the ways in which you thought you knew someone, or you thought you knew yourself, that bending causes panic. It does. Because you are not who you thought you were. And he or she or they are not who you thought they were. What does that mean for all of us? Because at the end of the day, we don't live in a silo. We kind of have to live with everybody, including those occupied states, right? That's all I have for you tonight. I wish I could go on because I could talk about this kind of thing forever, but I know that like that was a lot of information and material. If you have questions, I can totally hang out, or we can have a cigarette outside or something. If the Strand is saying that it's too late, so there you go. Thank you, everyone.